not be able to calm down their fear centers in the same way. And so then we decided that we would look at this almost exact same circuitry that BJ was looking at in the mice. And so we first had to design a behavioral study. I'll go over this fairly quickly, but it's actually quite simple. It's a Pavlovian fear task where you shock a mouse and pair the shock with a tone. So every time they hear a tone, they will be shocked 10 to 15 seconds later. And then what you do is every time they hear the tone, they will freeze. And this is what we measure. But if you can now start doing another experiment where you actually start playing the tone over and over again, they will now learn that a previously dangerous cue, this tone, is no longer dangerous. And a normal mouse, just like as BJ showed in her figures of the fearful faces that were being played over and over again, the mouse should stop freezing or freeze much less. And what we were able to show is that if you have a mouse that has two copies of the wild type allele, they will actually stop freezing, and that will freeze much less. But if you have two copies of the MET allele, they will continue to freeze even after 30 trials of playing this tone. So again, very similar to what BJ talked about. This is sort of something that now we have a genetic variant that might explain why some people might be more anxious than others, or why certain mice might be more anxious than others. But in order to actually to test this in humans, we had a very talented graduate student who BJ and I co-mentored, Fatima Solomon, who basically did almost identical task in humans, but instead of shocking the humans, she played a loud noise and paired it with a yellow square. So every time they saw a yellow square, or 50% of the time they saw a yellow square, they would hear this loud noise, and if they saw a blue square, they would not hear this loud noise. And then instead of asking them whether or not they were anxious, what Fatima did was she actually just measured how much sweat was on their fingertips, sort of a physiological biomarker for how aroused or autonomically fearful they are. And you can see that if you have one copy of the MET allele, you actually will continue to sweat every time you see a yellow square. So every time, and what then BJ and Fatima were able to do is to probe these same regions that BJ talked about, the ventral prefrontal cortex. These are all adult normal subjects, and you can see that if you have two copies of the wild type allele, you will activate this region. If you have one or two copies of this genetic variant, you cannot do not activate this region. And concomitantly, you actually look if she can. Fatima was able to also look at the amygdala, which was also quieted down after multiple trials of playing this yellow square. But if you have one or two copies of the MET allele, at the end of these extinction sessions, you will continue to be afraid of yellow squares and continue to activate your amygdala. So what we've been able to do is essentially go through a bottom-up, vertically integrated approach to try to understand why these animals have developed phenotypes that look like anxiety-like phenotypes, and that we've been able to find that they have an alteration in the ability to extinguish fearful cues, and that we were able to now confirm parts of it in actually human, normal subject humans, and we would like to continue to study this also in patient populations. But I think that when BJ and I were thinking about this, we were also wondering whether or not whether this polymorphism has any beneficial properties, because it's actually quite common in the population. It's been associated with as protective for certain psychiatric disorders. And the idea that BJ and Charles Glatt, our human geneticist who works with us also, was that maybe there's something going on during the transition between childhood and adolescence. And that's because of the neurobiology that we know that BDNF peaks during this exact period of time during the transition between adolescence. Just for everyone, P30 is the equivalent of an 8 to 10 year old child. So exactly at the time of adolescence is when this growth factor is peaking. And it's to this day we still do not understand to what extent they do that. But the bottom line is that what we realized is that no one had done these types of fear conditioning experiments across this same time period. And to make a long story short, what we found was that if we did the similar types of fear conditioning and we looked at the mice, we noticed that essentially, instead of playing the tone, we put them back into the context. So this is a slight variation. This is sort of like if you take your child to office, the next time they show up, they start crying the minute they go into the waiting room. They look at the spatial cues, they see that this is not a good place to be, and then they will start crying or to some. And so that what mice usually do, if they're adult mice, is they'll freeze 70% of the time. And what we noticed was, to make a long story short, is that something remarkable, that essentially that mice that are free adolescent actually will freeze just fine. If they're adults, they'll freeze just fine. But if they are going through this transition period between childhood and adolescence, they won't freeze, which is amazing that up until, this was published in 2011, that until 2011, no one actually knew that this period of time, this sensitive or this period of fear suppression existed. So it makes, in a way, it's quite counterintuitive that during adolescence, during a period of time when BDNF is rising, in normal mice, that they actually will look like they are not showing any fearful responses. And this is where science, we're having graduate students, in particular Siobhan Pathwell, was absolutely amazing because she did an experiment by accident. She took these mice, shocked them at this age of 8 to 10 years old, and then forgot about them. And then 2 months later, checked and just put them back into the context and saw that they froze. So there is a very interesting phenomenon here where you can actually have memories that are, for fearful memories that are suppressed and then can come back later on. And she did a large number of studies which I will show that essentially during this entire sensitive period which we're calling now, that you can do fear conditioning and they will not express fearful responses such as freezing, but if you wait 13 days as they transition out of this sensitive period, they will start freezing. And it suggests that this is a period of time when most likely, as BJ was saying, different brain regions are reorganizing, and there's something that's very unique about this period. And the clinical relevance is that, for example, as I mentioned, that is if you shock a mice at peak 28, which is just before the sensitive period, what you notice is that essentially they will freeze 80%. If you wait 3 days as they enter the sensitive period, we notice something amazing. So that they will, if you took 10 animals, shocked them at P28, waited until they enter the sensitive period, they will not freeze. If you wait then another period of time, they will actually, 13 days later, they will freeze if put back into this context. So it really suggests that the brain fear circuitry is reorganizing itself in a very unique way, and that there are endogenous mechanisms to suppress fearful responses during this period of time. And that actually, if we can do things during this period of time to intervene, we actually might be able to do things either behavioral or pharmacologically to potentially alter fearful responses. But the reason why I bring up this very sort of odd, idiosyncratic, interesting finding about fearful behavior is that the hypothesis is that if you have genetic alterations that actually decrease learning and memory to some degree, or consolidation of fearful memories, you actually might be protective. And that's actually what we've found, that if you take mice that have two copies of this genetic variant and test them at around 8 to 10 years of age in humans, that if you actually look 2 weeks later, they actually don't show any fearful responses. So essentially, what you have is a genetic variant that might be later on in life be quite anxiogenic and probably predispose you to anxiety, but early on might actually be protective. It actually might be something that will allow you to forget, because in many ways, anxiety disorders, in particular post-traumatic stress disorder, are disorders where you remember things too well. So this might actually serve in a way to actually act in different ways across development, and this may, one way we can sort of conceptualize genetic variants in a different way than has been thought of before. So the bottom line I want to suggest is that by doing these types of experiments in this neurodevelopmental way, we've been able to identify a sensitive period which we can now test, not just genetic variants, but potentially future therapeutic strategies, whether it be behavioral or pharmacological. And that by studying a genetic variant, we've actually learned a little bit more just about basic fear circuitry across development. And finally, I'm actually thanking the same people that BJ has thanked, because basically we work together, and this is the exact same list of people, almost. Thank you so much. Spectacular.